Antarctica. I know it, you know it. It's cold, it's generally covered in ice, and the parts that aren't covered in ice generally have some pretty cool fossils. I mean, maybe you don't quite know that part because it is a very select group of people who do have the opportunity to go to Antarctica to find fossils, but some of these fossils can be very illuminating. For example, a new Triassic amphibamiform named Micropholis stowi. This amphibamiform was actually already described in the 1800s, but it came from South Africa at that time period. So now we actually understand that it was more widespread than it previously was thought to have been. Antarctica was still relatively southern during this time period, and so finding an amphibamiform from the Triassic of Antarctica is still somewhat unexpected, despite the fact it still would have been slightly warmer than today. However, you may have noticed that I didn't say amphibian, I said amphibamiform, and that's because this animal was potentially not an amphibian. There's a lot of debate up about essentially what is an amphibian in the fossil record. And as far as we know right now, the amphibamiforms were not amphibians, but were closely related to the amphibians within the larger clade, Temnospondyli. And while I could hope that these new fossils of Micropholis could help indicate essentially how closely they are related, they don't, because there's only four of them and they're all fairly partial. However, they do show certain features that do suggest that they do in fact belong to the genus Micropholis. For example, there was a narrowing of the palatine bone on the skull. But even historically before this, Micropholis wasn't fully understood as how close it was to amphibians. And that's because it's the last of the lineage that disappears from the fossil record over 50 million years before it shows up. So it was essentially called a Lazarus taxon, where essentially a lineage disappears from the fossil record and then pops up somewhere else millions of years later. This isn't entirely uncommon, but it does happen, and it does help us understand exactly how widespread certain groups actually were and how long they lasted after major extinction events. And on the subject of extinctions, the lineage that led to Micropholis would have actually survived the Permian-Triassic extinction, the most severe extinction in history. And combined with other fossils from the time period of the early Triassic when Micropholis comes from, we can actually get a good understanding of how well the amphibians and their close relatives actually did during this extinction and how widespread they were. However, how widespread they were really depends on how fine of a resolution you're looking at. And that's because out of 30 species that are known from Africa, Australia, Antarctica, and India, Micropholis is one of only two that show up in two different locations, meaning that they were highly endemic. And so you can look at the broader group of Temnospondyli and see that there's 30 species of them, but they're all very limited in range. And while these are kind of the two extremes of the resolutions you can get, with one being wide resolution with the entire group Temnospondyli, and the other being very specific with a single species, but if we look at the other groups that are included within Temnospondyli, we can actually see that there's still a lot of variation, with this graph showing essentially the black dots being that they are present, the white dots being they're entirely absent, and the gray ones being essentially things that are still up for debate, mostly because the fossils are still too partial. So while Micropholis may seem like a relatively small piece of the amphibian evolution puzzle, when we look at the overall greater trends, in a sea of endemic animals, it was something that did much better than some of its closest relatives.